Okay, the next item of business is a debate on motion 8007 in the name of Tom Arthur on the Local Government Finance Scotland Orders 2023. I'd invite members wishing to participate in this debate to press the request to speak buttons as soon as possible, and I invite Tom Arthur to speak to and move the motion. Minister, around 7 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, today's debate on the Local Government Finance Order seeks Parliament's approval to the guaranteed allocations of revenue funding to individual local authorities for 2023-24. It also seeks agreement to the allocation of additional funding for 2022-23, which has been identified since the 2022 Order was approved on 2 March last year. We cannot ignore the hugely challenging circumstances in which we have had to agree the Scottish Budget this year. Inflation is still running at double digits, down to 10.1% in January. At the start of February, the Bank of England raised interest rates to 4%, the highest level in 14 years. Brexit too is continuing to cause harm and will continue to cause harm and have an adverse impact on our economy. And the International Monetary Fund has forecast the UK to be the only major economy to shrink in 2023, with the economy falling by 0.6%. Despite this, and within the limitations of the devolution settlement, we have used the powers we do have to protect public services, invest in the transition to net zero, and take decisive steps to eradicating child poverty. The Scottish Budget strengthens our social contract with every citizen of Scotland for the wider benefit of society. This means that people in Scotland continue to enjoy many benefits not available throughout the UK, including free prescriptions, free access to higher education and the child payment. That also applies at council level. People can access more local services than elsewhere in the UK, for example, more fully funded early learning and childcare for all 3- and 4-year-olds, a welfare fund delivered locally, and free bus travel for nearly 2 million people, including every child and young person under 22. Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government is providing nearly £13.5 billion in the 2023-24 local government finance settlement, including revenue support of almost £12.6 billion and support for capital expenditure of over £0.8 billion. Following the flat cash position set out in the resource spending review, we listened to councils and are increasing the resources available next year by £793 million. The 2023-24 local government finance settlement now provides an additional 6.3%, or a real terms increase of 3% compared to 2022-23. As we do every year to reach this number, we have compared the proposed budget to the allocations approved by Parliament in the previous year. This provides the best like-for-like comparison of available funding. Individual local authorities will also have full flexibility over local council tax rates and the newly devolved empty property relief. The Scottish Government also intends to introduce a local visitor levy bill to Parliament this year, giving local authorities a discretionary power and time to apply a levy on overnight visitor stays in their areas and utilise this additional funding locally. It is important to note that the total funding package is already finalised following the passing of the Scottish Budget Bill. Today's debate seeks Parliament's approval for the distribution of this approved total funding to individual local authorities. The Order seeks approval for the distribution and payment of almost £11.6 billion of the revenue total of £12.6 billion, with the balance mainly made up of specific grant funding, which is administered separately. This £11.6 billion is a combination of general revenue grant of over £8.5 billion and the distributable amount of non-domestic rates income, which has been set at just over £3 billion. This settlement also provides continued fiscal certainty through a policy of guaranteeing the combined general revenue grant plus non-domestic rates funding set out in this order. This means that any loss of non-domestic rate income resulting from the impact of Brexit or COVID-19 will be compensated for by increased general revenue grant, unlike the positions for councils in, for example, England, effectively underwriting this critically important revenue stream. As approved as part of the Scottish Budget, the overall funding package for 2023-24 includes £360 million to support the local government pay deals, £72.5 million increase to the general revenue grant, £105 million to give effect to the devolution of non-domestic rates empty property relief, an extra £50 million capital to help with the expansion of free school meals policy, Additional funding of £100 million to deliver a £10.90 minimum pay settlement for adult social care workers in Commission services, and consolidation of £30.5 million for the Homelessness Prevention Fund. There remains a further £330 million of revenue funding that will be notified to local authorities once the distribution has been discussed and agreed with COSLA. This will be included for approval in the 2024 order. And there is specific revenue funding which is paid directly by the relevant policy areas under separate legislation, amounting to almost £776 million. The 2023 order also seeks approval for almost £371 million of changes to funding allocations for 2022-23. The full list of changes can be found in the report to the 2023 order. Presiding Officer, this Government recognises the financial challenges that local authorities across Scotland and indeed the whole public sector are facing. We acknowledge the importance of providing more fiscal flexibility and more revenue-raising powers for local government. The fiscal constraints we share also emphasise the need to focus urgently on improving delivery of sustainable public services, designed around the needs and interests of the peoples and community of Scotland. But we must also continue to press the UK Government for additional funding for our shared priorities and pressures. I would welcome support from across the Parliament in this respect. The Budget Bill passed by Parliament last week ensured that total funding from the Scottish Government to local government next year not only increased in cash terms, but also in real terms. This order confirms the distribution to individual councils, and the proposals reflect the crucial role that local authorities and their employees continue to play in our communities. Presiding Officer, I move that Parliament approves the Local Government Finance Order for 2023.
Thank you, Minister. I now call on Miles Briggs for around 6 minutes, Mr Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And across the world, governments are meeting, as we are today, to discuss and approve budgets. And I was disappointed that the Minister didn't touch upon what has destabilised this whole process, and that is President Putin's illegal invasion of Ukraine. And I think ministers across the Scottish Government need to start recognising that and including that in where we are, not just inflation, not just Brexit, COVID-19, but the real impact of an illegal war in driving up prices and the inflation rate as well. Now, I want to start today by thanking all those who work in our local authorities across Scotland for their hard work and commitment to our communities, especially during the time of the COVID-19 pandemic, but also the work which they are undertaking to deliver recovery for our communities as well. I think that's something we should also very much recognise. And for my own council here in Edinburgh and also in Glasgow, the work which they are doing to support Ukrainians and Ukrainian families who are in Scotland is tremendous. And I think some of the pressures which I know my own council have highlighted to ministers around education and support for housing have not been addressed in this budget, but we need to make sure that that lasting and ongoing support is recognised by ministers. The order before us in Parliament today allocates funding for each of Scotland's 32 local authorities, and we do not intend to oppose it, but we will continue to raise and have serious concerns around the overall allocation of resources to local authorities across Scotland and the need for reform of how that's delivered. Council finance chiefs have warned SNP and Green ministers that Scotland's local authorities are now facing unprecedented financial pressures. And the Scottish Government's budget is the largest in devolution history, let's not forget that, thanks to additional UK Government funding being allocated during and after this budget process. Tracking funding allocations over the last decade, in fact, points towards SNP ministers not passing on or delivering the same additional resources which they have received, and passing on these on to local government. And that's something I hope today to be able to highlight, because we are having this debate annually, but we are not finding the solutions which we need for local government. Councils have been left facing a situation in which they have to find savings and cut local services at the same time. And this budget, this year's budget, across Scotland, we are witnessing how councils are having to take those difficult decisions and have come together yet again to condemn their financial settlement and the work of COSLA in that. And it's clear that we do need to see a new approach and conversation over how we take forward this budget process. The Acting Finance Secretary, John Swinney, mentioned in his speech last week during Stage 3 of the budget debate that the Scottish Government want to see a new deal with local government. And I agree, but I don't want that just set by the Scottish Government. I want Parliament and all local authorities to have that conversation as well, because ministers need to look towards how future finances are properly going to be delivered. And I hope SNP and Green ministers genuinely are able to pause and reflect following this budget on the difficulties which councils are already saying will present them at achieving any similar budget in the future. We need to see the resetting of the financial relationship between the Scottish Government and local government, and the development, I believe, of a new partnership that delivers respect between the Scottish Government and our local authorities, and gives local authorities the powers and funding that they need to deliver the vital public services that we all rely on. The Minister pointed towards a potential additional tax, which I believe only two councils are now looking at taking forward, so that wider discussion is needed over local government reform. And I believe a creation of a new fiscal framework for councils can provide that future provision and powers protected which local authorities currently hold and are respected. And that's where other debates, for example, around the National Care Service, need to also look at how this can be reformed. To date, that has presented very little scope for reform or discussion around that. But I hope outside of this budget process, there is that opportunity. And the opportunity that a new First Minister, new Finance Secretary, new local government ministers also present to build a new relationship and have that positive discussion over a new funding settlement. There seems to be a stalemate currently in opening up discussions around this important issue, but there needs to be reforms, and it's critical if we're able to work to protect and enhance our local councils and our local communities that that takes place in the future. Now, I don't doubt that councils will continue to face many difficult decisions in the coming weeks, months and years. But for the councillors I've met with and spoken to across Scotland, not only from my party but from all parties in this chamber, I can't see where councils can find any more flexibility. They have used the sticking plasters they had to get this budget across the line in many areas. There's nothing else for them to cut without just resorting to delivering core services and nothing else. So I hope that backdrop and the financial pressures we all recognise can be where we take this debate in the next year ahead of the next budget. I hope that SNP and Green ministers will reset their approach to how local councils are funded and their local priorities each local authority, urban and rural, have at delivering services. And that's something I hope all of us in this Parliament will play our role in, but more importantly, how we make sure our local authorities are actually able to deliver for our local communities. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr Briggs. I now call Mark Griffin for around 5 minutes, Mr Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We won't be opposing the order today because we know that it's necessary to get that funding allocated to councils, but as we did indicate at stage 1 and 3 of the budget, we do not support that 2023-24 budget because it is laced with yet more cuts, will cause rocketing council tax bills, and we could see up to 7,000 jobs gone from local government. Councillors in all 32 local authorities and every political party, including the SNP, are making or are having to make heartbreaking decisions that are of this government's making. £6 billion has been cut from services since 2013, but the government just seemed to look the other way. Roads are crumbling, libraries are closed, bins are overflowing, staff have been left with no option to strike, strikes that again have left schools closed right across the country, and now it's left to councillors to take the tough decisions to balance the books. Council tax increases of 5, 6, 7, up to 10% right across the country. Not only have the government passed the buck during the cost of living crisis when food, utility and housing bills are soaring, but the public will now have to pay for worse services, footing the bill for the SNP's neglect of local councils and local communities. In my own region, SNP-led Falkirk Council asked its executive to greenlight a plan to put 133 buildings up for sale. School pools, Grangemouth Stadium, sports halls, gyms, park buildings, village and community halls, all flogged to fill a deficit and with it 200 jobs. SNP-led Aberdeen City Council's review could see swathes of its services, things like social work, its welfare fund, council tax collection, health and safety enforcement, free school meals, all put up as options for outsourcing. But, Presiding Officer, the smoke and mirrors, the political spin, and I think at points the verging on dishonest presentation of the budget figures and their impact meant that there was absolutely no real debate about the budget, just game playing and spin that defied and denied reality. At the time, ministers complained about their budget, they complained about the changes in real terms, but then talked in the same breath about changes to local government budget in cash terms. They spent hours in this chamber demanding an honest discussion about where we would spend additional funding, where we would cut, but the truth is we had no honest starting point. We never even had a conversation. When the government claimed during the budget process, during their initial allocation, that there would be an uplift of £570 million to local government, where then was the honest conversation? Where could we possibly have an honest starting point when that was the government claim? But even if it was true, even if it was realistic, it was still only half of what COSLA had asked for what they said would need to protect essential services. But even that figure didn't make it to the end of the day, because the true number was £71 million when you took into account existing policy commitments. The Fraser-Valander Institute also set the record straight, making clear that the government's funding would represent a real-term cut to local government budgets. And even when we took the £223 million announced at Stage 3, that again was committed spend. It wasn't additional funding for councils to spend on protecting services, so it's left councils continuing to make cuts. But that announcement, like every other year, where the SNP say there is no more money, but then come to Stage 3 and allocate additional funding at the very last minute. Now, some councils had already had their budget meetings, some had already set their budgets. Now, when you come to the Chamber on the last day at Stage 3 to announce that additional funding, that's shown absolute contempt for so-called partners in local government.
As briefly as possible, Minister.
Thank you. I recognise that sometimes timing can be suboptimal, to put it mildly, but would the member recognise that ultimately we have to operate with any wider UK fiscal framework under Treasury rules, and that includes also late notification of supplementary estimates for ourselves within the financial years, which can have a cascading and knock-on effect?
Mark Griffin, and you should be winding up now.
I appreciate the timing of the allocation from the UK government, but this is a recurring theme. It's a pattern every single year in local government budgets where the government come to the chamber, they tell us there is no more money left, they ask us to identify cuts, and then the very last minute they announce extra money from the back of the sofa out of a hat, and that is absolutely treating local council colleagues with contempt. But, Presiding Officer, like I said, we'll vote for this order to allow councils to get the money allocated to them, but it's clear that it will result in more pain and misery for local communities. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr Griffin. And I now call Alex Cole-Hamilton for around 4 minutes.
Thank you very much indeed, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I start by offering my apologies to the Chamber for my late arrival? I was caught up in a broadcast interview that overran. Deputy Presiding Officer, the tone of Tom Arthur's remarks today is striking. It is completely at odds with what I am hearing from Liberal Democrat councillors at the sharp end of this. The government benches must be hearing that too. So I am surprised that Green and SNP members are happy to go along with it. I'm relieved that here in Edinburgh, thanks to the Liberal Democrats, over £5 million worth of school cuts have now been prevented. We promised to stop this assault on education, and we have delivered on that. But that isn't to say putting that budget together wasn't incredibly difficult, because the Scottish Government is still cutting Edinburgh's budget by a staggering £76 million. It's those sort of figures that mean elsewhere we are seeing school librarians cut, community wardens, early years staff cut, music tuition and outreach in some of the most deprived communities in the country cut. Now, listening to the government benches these last few weeks, it is clear that they have disengaged with the fact that local government is in crisis. Local government budgets have been eroded, squeezed to the pips year after year by SNP and Green ministers. And the consequences of that can be seen in the failure to close the poverty-related attainment gap to the potholes in our roads. I will briefly...
Briefly, Minister.
I'm grateful. I think what I'm inferring, and I think what the member's implying, is that there has to be a strategic realignment of funding priorities in government to give local government more money. That would necessitate significant reductions elsewhere. And in all honesty, we've got a budget process to go through next year and subsequent years. Does Mr Cole-Hamilton have a place he wants to take that money from?
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
I've told you exactly where I would take that money from. For a start, I'd get rid of the vast and unnecessary bureaucracy that is in ministerial takeover of social care. But I would also point the government to their own words, that you had said you would improve and protect local services, give greater control and influence of decisions. That's what the SNP promised last May. The Greens were at it too. They promised fair funding for our public services and devolved decision-making. Their words, Deputy Presiding Officer, it took just 26 days after making big promises at those council elections last May for Kate Forbes and her Green colleagues to unveil their plan for more savage cuts in the spending review. And last month, the Education Secretary introduced a fresh sanctions regime for local government that if they didn't do what the SNP Green government ordered, they would face penalties. And the Education Secretary, as such, is treating councils like the enemy who are determined to cut teachers' numbers. That's nobody's wish. Nobody's talking about that as a way forward. And the way to protect teacher numbers is to adequately fund our local authorities. It is a pattern that goes back to 2007, with the recently released Cabinet paper showing John Swinney threatened to, and I quote, centralise the delivery of school education to, in his words, play hardball with cause. None of this is collaboration and partnership like we were promised. It's putting local government and education in a headlock. And the Greens should listen to Andy Whiteman, their former respected member, writing in Holyrood last month. He said, the Scottish Government's enfeebling of local councils is an attack on our democracy. And he rightly suggests that we imagine the boot was on the other foot and the UK government were threatening financial penalties if Scottish ministers didn't follow the Tory government's own manifesto. Deputy Presiding Officer, local authorities need both a fair deal from this government and a power surge that recognises the importance of the work that they do. That means giving them more powers over economic development, planning and transport, and ending the SNP power grabs I've defined. They need new hope, not another ministerial takeover of social care and a vast and unnecessary bureaucracy that would asset strip and trample over services once again. And let me finish by coming on to council tax reform. Tom Arthur says it's a key priority. We know what that means. Like other key priorities before it, the SNP will make no reforms throughout the entirety of this Parliament. He has explicitly said nothing will be rolled out before 2026. And the Greens still can't see that they've gone into government on the promise of talks about talks, a working group, then a citizens' assembly. And at the end of all of that, we're being promised options. Options, Tom Arthur says, could be either anything from relatively minor to significant and fundamental. Talk about kicking something into the long grass. And you don't just have to take my word for it. Robin Harper, former leader of the Greens, agrees. Presiding Officer, there is no escaping the harm this local government settlement will deliver to our communities in every corner of Scotland, and the Liberal Democrats will oppose it this evening. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Cole-Hamilton. I now call on the Minister to wind up the debate for around 4 minutes, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to colleagues for their contributions. Just turning to Mr Cole-Hamilton's last remark, I appreciate he may disagree with the distribution and the allocation, but if he wants to distribute money to local authorities, he needs to vote for this, or at least not oppose it. Secondly, if I recall correct, I will check the official report. He said that I had been explicit or made clear that there would be no changes to council tax by the end of this Parliament. That's not what I said. I was specifically committed and was misreported, or at least reported with a particular tone which suggested other than what my intent was, which is, and I want to be very clear about this, the pace that we move on council tax reform will be determined by the outcome of engagement with COSLA and through a deliberative process. And I think members would recognise that in the spirit of working in partnership with local authorities and respecting them, it is one whereby we should not seek to impose a form of local taxation upon them, but to reach agreement and consensus and partnership. And I'll give way to Mr Cole-Hamilton.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Grateful to Tom Arthur for giving way. If I have misrepresented him, I apologise, in which case could he clarify for the Chamber, and I will correct the record if this is the case, will the council tax be reformed by the end of this Parliament, yes or no?
Minister.
If the member had listened to what I said before he intervened, he would understand that the pace of council tax reform is not a matter for government or this parliament alone. It is about reaching consensus and agreement with local government, with communities and through a deliberative process. Mr Cole-Hamilton may think it is just the job of parliament to impose a form of local taxation upon local government. We respect local government. We will work with local government in partnership to ensure that we deliver a form of reform where there is consensus. I want to say Mr Briggs touched on the issue of Ukraine, and I agree wholeheartedly with Miles Briggs that Ukraine and Russia's illegal and barbaric invasion has had a significant impact on not just the Scottish and UK economy, but the global economy. And I recognise that other members take that view as well. I would note that one of his colleagues, that when my colleague Jenny Gilruth was highlighting the need for reconsideration of timetables around the dualling of arterial trunk roads, clearly a major capital project, when amongst a range of reasons the war in Ukraine was cited, one of Mr Briggs' colleagues said that she even had the nerve to blame Vladimir Putin's concern of Ukraine. So I think it's very important in recognising if we're going to be adducing the invasion of Ukraine and the impact that that has had on the global economy as a consideration for the UK government's funding and for the Scottish government and the knock-on effects that has for their capacity to fund public services in Scotland. We have to apply that with some consistency. Presiding Officer, we are obviously in straitened financial circumstances. We have seen inflation at rates certainly unprecedented in my lifetime. This is not an ideal circumstance in which to be delivering a budget, but we have set out key priorities around that just transition to net zero on sustainable public services and in eradicating child poverty. And what this local government finance settlement does is provide a real terms increase to local government for the next financial year. But I would reiterate the point I made to Mr Cole-Hamilton and I made to others. If there is a desire for a significant and strategic shift in the Scottish budget to significantly increase the resources provided to local government, it is incumbent upon members to identify where that resource should come from. We can go round in circles every year in these debates, but unless there is a willingness to engage, I'm afraid I'm out of time.
The Minister's just winding
up. I'm afraid I'm out of time, Mr Briggs. But these are conversations I'm happy to have. But it has to be a serious, grown-up conversation. If we're talking about that strategic shift, that reorientation of how the budget is deployed, then it's incumbent upon members to engage with that seriously. And again, I would urge, in the interest of local government in providing fiscal stability, that members support the resolution this evening. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. That concludes the debate on the Local Government Finance Scotland Order 2023. We'll move on to the next item of business, but there'll be a brief pause before we do so.